Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. Today we're going to be talking about 14 pieces of advice I would give to my teenage self or to a teenager such as yourself. And if you're new here, my name is Giz Edwards. I am a lucid dreaming coach and entrepreneur based here in the UK. And in this channel, we delve into lucid dreaming, entrepreneurship, and more to make ourselves more relaxed, fulfilled, and enjoy life. I'm turning 30 this year. July the 4th, mark it in your calendars. It should be next to the words Independence Day. I've done a lot of reflecting. So here is a list of things that I wanted to tell myself when I was younger. It could be stuff that I wanted to know when I was younger. It could be stuff that I did know, but feel it's important to reiterate. Or it could be stuff that just really wasn't an issue when I was younger because of like technology or something like that. I don't know. There's a list of the time codes in the description box below. And if you want to flick around to each of the points, please be my guest. If not, watch the whole thing from start to finish, even better. But it's going to be a long one. That's what she said. With that out of the way, let's go on to number one. Do not go to university because someone says you should. Just for clarification for people watching in the United States, over here in the UK, we call it university. In America, you call it college, partly because here college is something completely different. So for the remainder of this video, I'm going to call it university. One of the stresses of being young is not knowing what it is that you want to do in your life. And to tell the truth, nobody really knows what they want to do. People look like they know, but they're basically making it up. So don't worry about that. It's very rare to see someone who knows what they want to do and is doing it. Out of all the people on the planet that I personally know, I only know one person who fits that criteria. They know exactly what they want to do and they are doing it. It's very rare to find. University is expensive, especially in America. And you don't want to make a decision when you're 17 that will impact you so much financially just because somebody else says that you should, or just because it's something that you feel like you should do but you don't really want to do it. If you're thinking about going to university, go through my flowchart. Do you have to get the degree to have the job that you want? Is it something that you really want to do? And are you willing to move location to do this job? My recommendation is if you said yes to all of these, then go for it. If you said no to some of these or all of these, then give it another thought because you're gonna be financially screwed. I regret doing my first degree. It was an undergraduate degree in applied sports science and coaching. The aim was to come out of it with the intention of being a teacher in secondary school. But halfway through my degree, I realized I didn't wanna do it. And afterwards I realized that I would have been better waiting and working and then deciding what I wanted to do. I ended up finishing the degree anyway because I was halfway through it, but if I could do it again, I probably wouldn't do the degree. In 2019, when I was 28, I did go back to university to do my master's degree because I knew it was something that I wanted to do rather than something that I thought I should do because somebody said I should, or because I just went with the flow of life. Give it some thought. I'm glad I waited. Number two, the Dunning-Kruger effect. The Dunning-Kruger effect is this weird psychological phenomenon which explains the relationship between what you think you know and what you actually know. And what they find is that people who know very little about a subject think they know a lot. And people who know a lot about a subject think they know very little. And it could be because people who know a lot about a subject realize how much more there is to learn about it, so they think they don't know a lot. So be cautious of people who claim to know a lot about a subject because it might actually turn out that they don't know as much as they think. But even more importantly, be cautious about how you talk to others about a subject you think you know a lot about, because it might turn out that you don't know a lot. And even though it looks like you're being boastful and like, oh yes, because I know this about minerals, it might come across as being douchery. Some people might enjoy it, but that'll be a very, very small percentage of people that actually think you're the bee's knees. Everyone else is pretty much just laughing at you. If you think you know more than somebody who's studied it for their life and you've done 3 months of Google research, I got news for you. Number three, learn to say these seven things. Yes, no, please, thank you, I don't know enough, I need help, and sorry. You need to say yes to things to get you out of your comfort zone. Do you want to do this? Yes. Do you want to do a study group? Yes. Do you want to be part of the geography after school program? Yes. Do you want to go jogging on the weekend? Yes. Get yourself up and out of your comfort zone. You often hear about people and how they're jealous of others' successes because of luck, or they're just lucky that they got in that situation. But what they don't realize is that most people who are lucky because of situations have put themselves in those situations because they have said yes to a lot of things. Doesn't just happen. You increase your chances of lucky stuff happening to you because you are doing more things. If I sat in this room every day for the rest of my life, which, judging on how things are going at the moment, might be a possibility, I won't have a lot of luck. If I was doing things in different locations of the world, with different people, opportunities just get drawn to me because I'm putting myself out there. On the other hand, you also need to be able to say no to things, and not like a like a firm no. I was going to put this in the original list of 14. However, some people that you meet aren't very nice to you, and they will peer pressure you into doing things that you do not want to do. There's a difference between being out of your comfort zone and being uncomfortable, and you have to just say no to those people and those things. Also, if you've got too much on your plate, you need to say no. People who peer pressure others into doing things usually target people who are weak with their no's. If you are strong with your no's, they probably won't target you. Get into the habit of saying please and thank yous. You hear it all the time, manners don't cost a thing. It's true, manners don't cost a thing. Yes, please, no, thank you. When you're talking to older people or people in a higher, like, hierarchy structure than you, like a teacher or a boss, and you are kind and courteous, they will remember that. Oh, he says his please and thank yous. And it doesn't matter who you're talking to. It could be somebody in the street who's asking you a question. It could be a checkout girl. It could be somebody ordering or delivering to you food. It could be a taxi driver. It doesn't matter. Manners don't cost a thing. Yes, please. No, thank you. And speaking fairly psychopathically here, if you are more courteous and kind to people, people will tend to do more things for you because they want you to succeed because you're a nice person. If you're ignorant or arrogant, people want to see you fail because you're horrible. Say that you don't know enough about something when you actually don't know enough about something to make an informed decision. I don't know why this is such a problem in the world at the moment, but we've got a lot of people claiming that they know a lot about stuff when they really don't, and it just muddies the water. I've been in the situation where somebody has asked me what is my opinion on the crisis in Palestine, and I said, I don't know enough about the crisis in Palestine to tell you what I think about it. And that is actually good. And if they say, well, why don't you know enough? Just say, I don't. Please send me some information and I will read it. And when they send you, or if they send you information, read it, learn a bit more. People look at you differently if you do that. Saying that you need help is massive. It does three things. First of all, people kind of empathize with those who make themselves look vulnerable. Number two, if you make yourself vulnerable, then people are willing to help just for the virtue signal sense of it. Yeah, I'll help this person in distress. Aren't I a lovely person? Number three, teachers will love the fact that you are willing to learn and you are not afraid to say that you need help in a subject. If you're in need educationally, physically, emotionally, socially, mentally, in need of help, ask for it. People will help. And finally, say sorry. This is probably the most powerful one on this list of things to say, but say sorry when you've messed up or you've done something wrong or you've made someone feel bad, you feel bad because of it. Just say sorry. But you have to be cautious because when you say sorry, it gives you an admission of guilt. For example, if someone crashes into your car and you say, oh my God, I'm so sorry, are you okay? It puts them as the victim automatically. I know it sounds really psychopathic again, but this is what happens in the world. So you have to be cautious about how you say sorry and when you say sorry, because you don't want to admit responsibility for something that you haven't done. Number four, learn these 9 skills: English, maths, ICT, social media, WordPress, marketing, touch typing, photography, and video editing. If you can master those roles or those skills, or not even master, get to just a competent level, you are incredibly dangerous in the workforce. You will make yourself indispensable. So if you learn basic ICT skills in conjunction with a standard grade for English and maths, you can learn spreadsheets and Word documents. You can do copy. You can do all sorts of things. If you can learn WordPress, you can update your employer's website. If you know how to touch type, it's the easiest way to increase the output from you to something else. If you're trying to think of something, but you're limited by your output of how slow you type, fix that. Fix that, like, tomorrow. Because if you can type real quick, you can get out more information out of your brain. If you learn how to do photography, like the composition of shots, and then you also learn how to do video editing, the same rules apply for composition for video editing. Couple that with your social media skills and your marketing skills, you are just powerful, powerful member of the workforce. But on top of that, and here's where it's most important, with those skills, you can create your own business. You can enhance your personal brand to help further my own career, let alone my employer's careers. Number five, problems arise from these four situations: not communicating to others, not understanding what you're doing, incompetence from other people and yourself, and malice from other people. To solve this, read the mission brief, understand what you're doing with it. If you don't know what you're doing, ask for help. People often fail things because of lack of communication. Oh, I thought you were paying the bills. No, I thought you were paying the bill. Doesn't matter. Someone's got to pay the bill. If you had talked about it, it would have been solved. How many times have you seen a TV show, like a soap opera or a teen rom-com or anything like that, where the problem is because the characters don't talk to each other? Communication is key. Sort it out. But incompetence and malice, my friend Dan says, do not assume somebody's being malicious towards you if incompetence is an option. People are malice, some people are incompetent, and you've got to figure out which is which. Number six, own your mistakes. Sometimes you find yourself in a situation where you failed at doing something and you have to accept the responsibility of doing so. Own it. Own your mistakes. Do not push blame onto other people when you could say easily, oh, Dave or John or Lucy could have done blah, blah, blah. No, no, no. It was your responsibility to chase up Dave, to chase up John, chase up Lucy to see who was going to get it done. This is especially important if you are a team leader. If your team succeeds, it is a team win. If your team fails, then it's your loss. It's your responsibility to own up and make things right. If you point the finger at someone, there's three fingers pointing straight back at you, man. Own it. Number seven, failure is not bad. Failing is not the same as failure. And failing is not a bad thing, truly. It is important that if you fail at doing something, you need to understand why you failed and learn not to do that thing in the future. You see this a lot with businesses. It's good to see somebody who's got a couple of failed businesses under their belt, because then they learn from those mistakes to make their future businesses better. It's good to see. There is an old saying, and it's still true: fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. Learn from your mistakes. Failing is not failure. Number eight, learn a form of self-defense, even if it's just a little bit. I've been in situations where I've had to fight to get out of the situation. Twice it's happened, and both times I would have been seriously screwed, especially the second time, if I didn't know a little bit of self-defense. And it could be any self-defense: judo, karate, jiu-jitsu, Krav Maga. It could be boxing or kickboxing, whatever it is. Just learn enough so that you can defend yourself, because even if you learn a little bit, it's probably still going to be more than most people know. So learn how to defend yourself. I learned two martial arts a little bit, to a slight competent level. One was karate and the other was KFM, or KC fighting method. And for those of you who don't know what that is, it's the same fighting style that Batman uses in the Christopher Nolan films. You might think that it's alpha and big and macho to be in a fight and, you know, fight your way out of it, but it's not. It's stupid. If you can run, run from a fight. There's no point being macho if you're unconscious. Doesn't matter how macho you are unconscious. And remember, it's very easy to kill someone or get killed in a fight. Way easier than you think. So learn anything, just a small amount. Number nine, if it feels bad, it probably is. If you're doing something and you get that feeling like, oh, this is bad, man, I shouldn't be doing this, stop. It's probably bad. This could be you saying something nasty to someone, or it could be you doing something because of peer pressure. Somebody's tricking you into doing something, like shoplifting, I don't know. If it feels bad, stop, because it probably is. Number 10, sleep is important. It's not cool to stay awake all the time. Oh man, I only had 4 hours sleep. Take it from someone who suffers with insomnia, or had suffered with insomnia, and also someone who has studied sleep for their dissertation at university. You need to sleep. If you're a teenager, get 8 to 10 hours of sleep. a night. That's the recommended, 8 to 10 hours of sleep every night. Sleep is, to me, one of the core pillars of being a healthy person. It's so much so that I can't even break it down in this video because there's so much that goes into it. Number 11, sticks and stones. This saying is slowly being phased out of our modern lexicon as time progresses. Sticks and stones may break your bones, but words will never hurt you. If someone says something mean to you, so what? Who cares? Usually when someone says something mean to you, it's to make themselves feel better because they feel awful. And the best way to bring yourself up, or the quickest way to bring yourself up rather, is to pull everyone else down. If you meet decent people, they don't do this. Sometimes it can be difficult to ignore what somebody has said, especially if you think it's true yourself, but just ignore them. And if you're going to change yourself because of what somebody else has said, don't do it for them. Change it because of you. Change because you want to better yourself, not because someone else has made you feel bad. There's a link in the description box below to a stand-up comic who says the most perfect thing about this subject. I saw him live when he said this, and I lost it. He's funny. He's a funny guy. Number 12. If a friend does something bad, it's your responsibility to call them out on it. Just because they're your friend doesn't mean they're exempt from doing bad things. If they do a bad thing, call them out on it. It may be tough, it may be awkward, it may be weird to communicate to them, and they might say something like, "Oh, I thought you were like my friend, bruv. I thought you had my back, bruv." And you say, "Nah, mate, I've only got your back if you are innocent or you do nothing wrong." And if they stop being your friend because you have called them out for being horrible, then they weren't a good friend to begin with. So show me your friends and I'll show you your future. Number 13, the friends that you make in school will not stick around forever. I got told this a lot when I was a kid. The friends you make in school won't be the friends you keep forever. And I thought, nah, my friends are going to be the exception to that rule. Spoiler alert, we weren't. In the primary and secondary school, the college, the university, and the second university course that I went on, I am friends with exactly one of those people. I'm still friendly towards everyone, but I don't regularly speak to or regularly meet any of them apart from one person. Everyone else that I have met in my life, who I'm good friends with, are a combination of friends of friends, work colleagues, friends of work colleagues, family members, friends of family members. Very rarely do I have a school friend as a friend. And that's not a bad thing. Your friends, when they leave school, they have their own lives, they have their own things that they're doing, and they're probably not hanging around you, not because they don't want to, but because they've got stuff on. And finally, number 14, time moves fast. I still can't believe that it's nearly 15 years since I've left school. It's gone by real quick. And this bit of advice comes from Ferris Bueller.
Yep. I said it before and I'll say it again. Life moves pretty fast. You don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
So that was my exhaustive list of 14 things that I would tell a teenager for advice. If you're not a teenager, what was your favorite bit of advice in this video? Write it down in the comment section below, or if you have some other piece of advice to give a teenager, let us know what that is. The most important lesson you learned from being a teenager. There were so many other things that I wanted to talk about, but I think I'm going to make another video about this aimed at like the 20-year-olds. So if you want to see that, stick around, subscribe, all that jazz, click on the links below in the description. Or if you want to see why my name is Giz, then check out this video. And for my subscribers, I will see you on Friday. Bye.